you for joining us at Hope Lutheran Church. We are so glad that you are here. And if you could do me a favor and like and subscribe to our YouTube channel, it helps us reach more people with the good news of Jesus Christ. Now, Pastor Carl is on a cruise in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean right now. Pastor Gerald is probably letting his hair flow in his Jeep in the middle of the desert, leaving me here alone. Except I'm not alone. I've got Jesus and I've got you. So I'm so thankful that you are joining me as we worship Jesus Christ today. And so if you want to help us reach more people with that good news of Jesus Christ, there's a couple ways you can do so. One, you can mail in an offering to Hope Lutheran Church at 45900 Portola Avenue in Palm Desert, California, 92260. You can also, I'm alone. You can text to give, 84321. And finally, you can go to hopepd.org. There you'll find all of the amazing things that are happening right here at Hope. Like our high schoolers are going to be going to the National Youth Gathering in New Orleans this year. They're also going to be going to Camp Pondo. We also have our Camp Hope coming up in June. So a lot of activities for all of the families that are joining us right here at Hope, and I hope that you will be one of them. So go to hopepd.org. Now, I think let's get to it, huh? Let's worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The reading for today comes from the book of Acts, the 8th chapter. Then an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go toward the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home. Seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to his chariot and join it." So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe this generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "About whom, may I ask, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip began to speak, and starting with this scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here's water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they had come out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And let us pray. Gracious God, may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you this day, O Lord. Amen. Well, have you ever heard the phrase, "There is no such thing as a stupid question"? Well, the comedian Stephen Wright once tried to challenge that old adage. So he nominated some of his own, like, "How do you tell when you're out of invisible ink?" And if Barbie was so popular, why do you have to buy her friends? And what happens if you get scared half to death twice? My personal favorite is, "If there's a gene pool, then why isn't there a lifeguard?" Well, as much as he tried, I still believe that there is not such a thing as a stupid question. And I think our reading today proves it. The entire story is centered on a question that comes from an Ethiopian eunuch who asks Philip, "What is to prevent me from being baptized?" Seems like an easy enough question, right? But before we can answer, we need to understand a little more about both Philip and the eunuch. Now, Philip was one of the first followers of Jesus and was from a small Jewish village on the north side of the Sea of Galilee called Bethsaida. Now, Bethsaida was part of a region called the Orthodox Triangle, one of the most religiously devout regions outside of Jerusalem at the time. In places like Bethsaida, there were strict rules for Jewish people about what you could and couldn't eat, serious observance of the Sabbath, faithful attendance at the religious feasts in Jerusalem, prayers every day, extensive laws about what you could touch, what you couldn't touch, who you could touch, who you couldn't touch. Philip came from a very small world of committed Jewish worshipers of God, doing everything they could to be true to their religion. And then Philip met Jesus and everything changed. Philip left his village to follow Jesus, deserted him at the cross, reconnected with him after the resurrection, and now he's on a road leading out of Jerusalem. Not just any road, mind you, but a wilderness road. This would have meant that there were no places to get provisions like food or water. Not a single 7-Eleven or Starbucks, which meant Philip would have to rely solely on God to provide. Philip would have to trust God. And it's there that he meets an Ethiopian eunuch. Luke tells us that the eunuch is reading from the book of Isaiah and wants to know who Isaiah is talking about in a particular passage. The eunuch wants to know more about Jesus. Now, what Philip says makes so much sense to the eunuch that he and Philip pass a body of water, and the eunuch says, "Look, here's water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" Well, lots of things, actually. The book of Deuteronomy and Leviticus make it very clear that because eunuchs could not produce children, they were not allowed to fully participate in the worship life of Israel. As a good conservative Jew, Philip would have viewed the eunuch as damaged goods and refused to baptize him on that basis. If Philip baptizes the eunuch, he will be breaking a serious rule that he was raised to respect and follow, a rule that determined your standing with God. And not only that, but the eunuch is from Africa, which for a small town conservative Jewish man like Philip is the ends of the earth. And look at how the eunuch was traveling, in a chariot. Chariots were the first century equivalent of tanks, and throughout scriptures are used as a symbol of empire, oppression, and violence. You would never approach someone in a chariot unless you were invited to. But look at what Philip does. He runs up to him and actually gets in. Luke gives us another detail about the eunuch. He is in charge of the treasury of the Queen of Ethiopia. Now, the chariot detail was significant, but eunuch's job? That's huge. First, he's working for a queen, not a king, something frowned upon by his people at the time. Second, he's in charge of the wealth of one of the major empires of the time. So, with all this stacked against the Ethiopian eunuch, what does Philip do? He baptizes him, makes him part of the body of Christ. Everything that Philip had ever been taught about God said to stay as far away from this man as possible. But now God was speaking something new. This story is thick with the presence of the Holy Spirit, which raises interesting questions about how that Spirit works. If God is the lawmaker, then God is also the law transcender, who both places limits on the faithful and inspires them to challenge those limits when right relationships with God and neighbor are at stake. This dynamic shows up in both Testaments, not just one. When Philip follows the Spirit's leading to go to the Ethiopian eunuch, he follows in the footsteps of his ancestor Elijah, who was led by the Lord to a widow of Zarephath. God challenges Philip to do something he never thought he would do. The Holy Spirit challenges Philip to expand his view of who God is, who God loves, and what God can do. Jesus calls him into a situation that was uncomfortable and frightening and accomplishes amazing things. And God wants to do the same with you. Where is God challenging you in your life? Where is Jesus pushing you to go that you might find uncomfortable? What astounding, remarkable, and overwhelming acts is the Holy Spirit demanding of you? What barriers are to sharing the love and grace and mercy of Jesus Christ the Spirit removing from you? Perhaps it's reaching out and restoring a broken relationship with a friend or family member. Perhaps it's calling you to more boldly live out your faith by volunteering in the community or being more diligent in your study of the Bible. Maybe it's seeing past a barrier you've created, preventing you from fully accepting someone. Sometimes where the Holy Spirit pushes us to go can be challenging, frightening, or uncomfortable. Sometimes our faith seems like a place where all our answers get questions. But that's okay, because when we trust in Jesus and go where God wants us to go, we will always be like that eunuch, leaving rejoicing. And for that, we give our thanks and praise. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks that the Holy Spirit both guides us and challenges us to go to unknown places, to do unknown things. Lord, we ask that Spirit move us that we may go out and make a difference in the world. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Now let's sing together. Thank you, Pastor Derek, for that wonderful message. I'm just teasing. Let's continue our worship as we confess our faith found in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And as we are gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And before you receive that benediction, if you can once again like and subscribe to our YouTube channel, helps us reach more people hear that good news of God's love. Now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant to you his everlasting peace. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.